book of 2 Kings in the Old Testament. 2 Kings chapter 4, if you'd stand with me as I read the scripture, I'll be reading verses 1 through 7. 2 Kings chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. One of the wives of the sons of the prophets cried out to Elisha, "Your servant, my husband, has died. You know that your servant feared the Lord. Now the creditor is coming to take my two children as his slaves." And Elisha asked her, "What can I do for you? And tell me, what is in your house?" She said, "Your servant has nothing in the house except a jar of oil." And he said, "Go out and borrow empty containers from all your neighbors. Do not just get a few. Then go in, shut the door behind you and your sons, and pour oil into all these containers. Set the full ones to one side." So she left. And after she had shut the door behind her and her sons, they kept bringing her containers, and she kept pouring. And when they were full, she said to her son, "Bring me another container." But he replied, "There aren't any more." Then the oil stopped. So she went and told the man of God, and he said, "Go sell the oil, pay your debt, you and your sons can live on the rest." You may be seated. I'd like to speak to you this morning under the topic, running on empty. There's something about me that wants the challenge of seeing how close I can get to where I want to go on the least amount of gas. Sometimes I hate to stop for gas, but I know my car well enough to know that when it's getting low, it shows how many miles are left. And then after a while, the number of miles vanishes. And then there's something that flashes up and down. And as it flashes up and down, I know I'm getting closer and closer. I've been known to wait to get gas when it's about 2 cents cheaper than the place that I'm near. I find out that it is exciting to wonder how far this tank will go. We have lots of expressions for running out of gas. I'm out of gas. My reserves are gone. I feel depleted. I'm running on empty. And if you're here this morning and you're running on empty, this story is for you. The first thing I see is the predicament in verses 1 and 2. Now one of the wives of the sons of the prophets cried out to Elijah, "Your servant, my husband, has died. You know that your servant feared the Lord. Now the creditor is coming to take my two children as slaves." I want to ask you this morning, what is your predicament? What is the area in your life where you need the grace of God to show up for you? All of us have leaks that create an emptiness in our souls. And these leaks are warning lights that tell us that something is rotten in Denmark. All of us have times of depletion, and we know that there are times that we are on the brink of giving up, the brink of defeat. What does emptiness look like? Many times it's a prodigal son that sits across from you at the kitchen table. At other times, it's limited resources so that you're not quite sure how you're going to have enough money to have your kids experience higher education. For some of you, it's a relationship that's toxic, and you know you ought to let go of it, but you just hang on for dear life. For others of you, it's an addiction that robs you of your fear and of your joy. Or perhaps it's anxiety. Anxiety creates many sleepless nights. And if you were honest, you would say, "I'm like the widow and the orphans. My life is falling apart." See, there was emotional pain. Her husband had died and she was lonely. There was financial pain. She was wondering if her sons would have to go into servitude. There was physical pain as she looked in the cupboard and there was no food for her and her sons. And there was spiritual pain as she realized that my husband feared the Lord and yet the Lord took him. See, I want to tell you today that Satan's constant assault is aimed at the goodness of God. When things fall apart, we ask the question, why would a good God allow all this suffering? Where is God when I hurt? And our deepest questions center around God's presence. It is God's perceived absence that troubles our souls more than anything else when we're running on empty. But I need you to see this morning that your problem isn't your problem. You need to get beneath your problem to see with clarity what our greatest need. Yes, it's important to name the darkness, but you have to get beneath the darkness to unlock your greatest need. Can I tell you today that your greatest need is to know God better? See, we want a Savior. We want a Savior from our financial pit. We want a Savior from our marriage. We want a Savior for the job that just doesn't seem to get any better. We want a Savior for our hopelessness and our sadness. But I want to remind you that the Savior, Jesus Christ, is a Savior from sin and disobedience. The cross is the answer to life's predicaments. Jesus didn't come to make us happy. He came to make us holy. He didn't come to make our lives successful and prosperous. He came to make our lives deep and meaningful. See, we want to look good without being good. We're more concerned about the appearance of our cars than the salvation of our neighbors. We want relief from all our troubles. We don't want a redeemer who will redeem our souls. C.S. Lewis said it this way: put first things first and we get second things thrown in. But if you put second things first, we lose both the first and the second things. Will you put your relationship with Jesus Christ first and foremost in your life? Do you realize that if you seek God and His kingdom, all the things that you need will be added to you? First, it's a blessed Savior. And secondly, it's His sacred blessings that He gives us. See, Jeremiah tells us in chapter 2, verses 13 and 14, "For my people have committed a double evil. They've abandoned me, the fountain of living water, and they've dug cisterns for themselves, cracked cisterns that cannot hold water." I'm afraid that some of us are more committed to power in our life than we are Jesus Christ. It's important to us that people look up to us and respect us and envy us. For some of you, the most important thing is somehow amassing as many possessions and comforts as you can. Recently, I was with a friend at lunch, and the owner of the restaurant came and started talking to my friend. For an hour, they tried to outdo each other. The hotel they stayed in France, the rental property in Dana Point, on and on and on. Finally, my friend excused himself and went to the restroom, and so I was alone with the owner of the restaurant. And he said to me, "Do you travel much?" I could have given him a list of the destinations that we've had in our life, the number of cruise days on a ship, but I just simply said, "We like cruising." I wasn't going to play the game. For some of you, your broken cistern is called peace, and you'll do anything to have peace as you medicate yourself to feel better, to make it through the next day. The second thing I see is potential in verse 2. Elijah asked her, "What can I do for you? And tell me what is in your house?" Two questions that bring clarity to a desperate situation. In the midst of acute pain, Jesus frequently asked the needy one, "What can I do for you?" Not because he didn't know what they needed, but he wanted them to acknowledge what they needed. See, usually our pain is obvious, but Jesus knew that asking the question would reveal what was in the person's heart. If you could ask the Savior for one thing this morning, what would be your cry? The second question is, what is in your house? She responded with saying, "I have nothing except a little oil in a jar." Nothing and more of nothing. She was in a desperate situation. She had no money, no food, no paychecks, no gift cards, no money in the couch, no recycling bottles and cans. She had a whole lot of nothing. And I believe that we have to come many times to the end of ourselves before God can begin with us. Because it's out of the emptiness that God brings fullness. Don't you realize that the fuller you are, the less God can do for you? We try to be so self-sufficient. But God asks us to come with empty hands so that he can fill our cups to overflowing. True worship usually begins in a desert. When everything falls apart, when your plans have backfired, when your schemes have failed, then it's time for the Lord of the universe to begin a good work in your heart. Because you know it's his work and not yours. Verses 3 and 4, I see the participation. There was the predicament, the potential, the participation. Then he said, "Go out and borrow empty containers from all your neighbors. Do not just get a few. And then go in and shut the door behind you and your sons and pour oil into all these containers." God is quite capable of doing all of his miracles without any of our help. But do you realize as we read the word of God that frequently God delights in using others to participate in his miracles? We were made for each other. We were designed for community. That's why we come to church on Sunday instead of sitting at home and watching a television program. We are better together. Now, this doesn't make sense. Here's a woman who has a little oil, and she's asked to ask her neighbors for empty vessels. Elijah says, "Go to your neighbors and get a whole lot of nothing. You have nothing, and now you're going to go ask your neighbors for more of nothing. Collect nothing." That will be the key. What is God doing? He's helping this desperate woman enter into the lives of other people. See, one of the reasons depression deepens is because we tend to isolate ourselves and only think of me, myself, and I. God is helping her to reach out outside of herself and see that the answer lies in her neighbor's houses. Some of us are too proud to ask for help. Some of us are too proud to even ask for a glass of water when we're thirsty. And what is your greatest need? How does God somehow want to adjust your vision so instead of looking at your problems, you look at him? Don't you realize that emotional healing always takes place in the context of relationships? You can't get healthy alone. Greeting and ushering is all about relationships. See, greeting and ushering is serving. It's giving of yourself each Sunday. It's leaving your problems in the hands of the shepherd and being here for other sheep who need a smile, who need a listening ear, who need a little pat on the back. The church needs a pastor. The church needs a choir. The church needs worshipers, but don't forget that the church needs ushers and greeters. For many people, you're the first face they see. And God can use you to be a key to helping someone feel welcome or unwelcome. Your eyes will tell the story. Don't you know that you're a doorkeeper in the house of your God? Story is told of Thomas Jefferson. He was on a horse crossing a river. And as he began to cross, there was a young boy who asked if he could sit on the back of the horse and ride across the river with him. When they got to the other side, a young man stopped the little boy and said, what made you ask him for a ride? The little boy said, his face said yes. Greeters, ushers, does your face say yes? That's what you need. That's what you need, because if your face says yes, these people will no longer become invisible, but visible to you. Elisha said, get as many jars as possible. It's really not that heavy, okay? Now, jars could be attractive or plain. They can be big. They can be small. They can be tall. They can be short. Please do not use the word short when you're around me, okay? I don't know. I just don't appreciate it, all right? The appearance and size is not as important as the contents. I hear Paul's words, not many wise from human perspective, not many powerful, not many of noble birth. Instead, God has chosen what is foolish in the world to shame the wise, getting more nothing. And God has chosen what is weak in the world to shame the strong, getting more nothing. God has chosen the insignificant and the despised in the world, what is viewed as nothing to bring to nothing what is viewed as something. Are we foolish today? Are we weak today? Are we insignificant today? Are we despised today? If so, you are in the very spot where God can use your nothingness to fill up the empty places in the kingdom of God. So I encourage you to round up as many jars and pots and containers as you can. I ask you to ask your neighbors and ask your family and ask your friends. I invite you to enter into other people's lives with purpose and prayer, knowing that God will always use your greatest hurts to minister to the hurts of other people. It happens over and over and over again. I frequently said, Lord, don't use that. But he says, that's what I want to use. That's what I want to use. And if I can't use that, I can't use you. Don't you know that God will use your past to help someone in the future? Next, I see the provision in verses 5 to 7. So she poured the oil into all the containers and set the full ones to one side, and then she left. And after she had shut the door behind her and her sons, they kept bringing her containers, and she kept pouring. And when they were full, she said to her son, bring me another container. But he replied, there aren't any more. And then the oil stopped. For decades, I've loved the Annie Johnson Flint poem, He Giveth More Grace When the Burdens Grow Greater. He sendeth more strength when the labors increase. To added affliction, he adds his mercy. And to multiple trials, he adds his peace. When we have exhausted our store of endurance, when our strength has failed ere the day is half done. When we reach the end of our hoarded resources, our Father's forgiving is only begun. For his love has no limits. His grace has no measure. His power and boundary is not known unto men. For out of his infinite riches in Jesus, he giveth and he giveth and he giveth again. God delights to give to his children. When our kids were small and we were living in a little condominium in Cyprus, you know it's small that when you're sitting at the kitchen table, you can reach all the appliances. Pat would ask me the question, the kids or the kitchen? Which was really her way of saying, do you want to wash the dishes and pots and pans and put them away, or do you want to give the kids their bath? Because I'm a clever person, I would look around and see how many pots and pans there were before I made this monumental decision. So one night I decided to take the kitchen, and we just happened to have for dinner Kraft dinner. Remember Kraft dinner? It's for people who are on a budget. And I got that Tupperware bowl and that Tupperware top, and I was trying to put all this Kraft macaroni and cheese into that container, and there was too much mac and cheese and not enough container. But I was going to be stopped by this. I was going to do it, and I got that lid and started pushing it around, you know, and it was started to pop up. And it was as if at that moment God whispered to me and said, Marv, that's how you are when I want to bless you. I say I'm unworthy. I say stop, it's enough. And he says, I want to give to you. I want to love you. I want to believe in you. I want to use you. I also want you to notice that the provision of God happened in the privacy of her own home, where no one could see except her sons. May I say to you that if you are expecting a word from God, it might not happen here at Second Baptist Church. It will happen during the week as you spend time with God. When you slow down and turn the motor off and listen for that still small voice, the Lord will show up for you. In seven verses, she goes from being a beggar to an entrepreneur. Elijah said, she went and told the man of God and said, and he said, go sell the oil, pay your debt, and you and your sons can live on the rest. Not just enough to get out of debt, but enough to go on and on and on. I believe that debt is one of Satan's most effective tools in keeping us from investing in God's kingdom. Oh, we love God, but we're unable to give because we've already given to Capital One and Visa and MasterCard. Even without the MBA, here was a lady who began to enjoy the richness of the obedience of following the prophet's instruction. Are you waiting today for a word from God? Do you realize that the words from the Father only come to those who are desperate and hungry for God's way? What does it take to have a life without lack? What does it take to somehow be nourished and fed so that you're not running on empty? I believe that the answer that is so simple and yet profound is that it can only happen when we fill our minds with the Word of God. Committing scripture to memory will allow you to practice the presence of God in your everyday life. Charles Spurgeon tells us that there's not a promise, not a word in the Bible that's not ours. In the depth of tribulation, it will comfort. In the midst of waves of distress, it will cheer. And when sorrows surround, it will be our helper. See, every Sunday morning, the sanctuary is filled with people who are needing a word from the Lord. And each Sunday, we have an opportunity to enter into the hurts of another person. But unless we have scripture at our fingertips, we will be silent to address the storm. I was thinking this week that there are five scriptures that I believe that every child of God, every usher, every greeter should have committed to memory. Joshua 1:9. Psalm 119, verse 11. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. John 1, 12. Romans 8, 38 and 39. 1 Corinthians 10, 13. Hebrews 13, 5. 1 Peter 5, 7. 1 John 1, 9. 1 John 5, 11 and 12. See, people are looking for hope. Not necessarily in an answer. But when God's word is used effectively, it will inspect you. It will correct you. It will direct you. It will protect you. And it will perfect you. Just Friday, a couple days ago, I was getting ready to leave LA Fitness. It's about 10 in the morning, maybe 9:30, I don't know. And I saw a brother there that attends our Christ Redeemer Church. I hadn't seen him in a month, and so I went up to him and I said, so how was your vacation? He said, well, I didn't actually have a vacation, I had surgery. He said, I had a tumor the size of an egg next to my prostate. He said, I've had quite a month. So how do you go from how was your vacation to how's your prostate? I mean, you know, how do you do that? So I've found that if you don't know what to say, don't say anything at all. Okay. That's advanced training for helpers. I don't know if you realize it, but that's it. As we were walking out the door, he said to me, I believe that God allowed me to have this tumor so that I can encourage my brothers in Christ in the area of detection and prevention. Are you getting bitter better in your life? Do you realize that God loves you so much that he will never allow anything to come into your life that he can't turn around for your good and for the good of other people? I invite you to pray with me. Father God, help us to be people of your word. We don't have to memorize chapters and chapters of Scripture, but there are some verses that we ought to know. And that when we see the struggles of people, that we'll be able to know what Scripture might fit and might encourage. Lord, thank you that we can get beneath our problems and find you. We say with Paul that our greatest joy is to know Christ and his resurrection. That even though we have this treasure in earthen vessels, we realize that it is the power of Christ that will shine through for all of us. So, Father, we ask not only for the ushers and the greeters, but we ask for ourselves that we might be instruments this week, instruments of realizing that even though we feel like we have nothing, that we have you to give away. For Jesus' sake and for your kingdom, we pray. Amen. I invite you to stand with me as we open the doors of the church. Perhaps you've known about Christ, but you've never really ever invited him to come and be your Savior from sin. Maybe even know John 3:16, but you've never claimed its promise. God gave his Son, but you've never received him. I invite you to unwrap that gift today and to come to the Savior. And find in him a new life. Father, dismiss us with your blessing. We might have empty hands, but we have you. And you are enough. Enough for everything that ever comes into our lives. And so we lift you up. We praise you. We realize that we can't say thank you enough. That you've redeemed us and you've filled us with your Spirit, and you've promised that every good and perfect gift that comes from heaven will be part of our portion. In Jesus' name we thank you. Amen.